Hello and welcome. On Fireworks today, governance in Ekiti State, the fountain of knowledge, is in view with an urgent need to understand government's perspective on and reasons informing some of its policy decisions. This is especially because of the myriad of criticisms coming from within and outside the state. Of course, we'll be talking with someone who should know. Let's take a short break. We'll be right back. Thank you for staying tuned. I am Bukola Samuel Wemimo. Today we'll be talking with the Commissioner for Information in Ekiti State and former lawmaker in Ekiti State Assembly, in the person of Honorable Larry Ogushue. Thank you for your time, sir. Can you enlighten us on some of the development of infrastructure in Ekiti State and some of the reasons informing this infrastructure development in different parts of Ekiti State?
This is a people-based government. This is a government that is brought to be by the collective will of the people of Ekiti State. So every decision, every project, every program that we have is people-based. We have a six-point developmental program. Empowerment, youth development, educational restoration, infrastructural development, of course our own stomach structure, you know, and agriculture, science and tech. Those are the six areas. But in tackling those six areas, we deliberately make it people-based. So our priority will be what benefits the greater majority of the people of Ekiti State, not a few elites. We make roads because we look at the number of people that are going to be using that route and who are suffering from the, you know, because there is paucity of funds. We also deliberately make sure that we put in place programs that are not party sensitive. When we came in, all the roads in the state capital were in bad shape. We had to embark on, you know, zero tolerance for potholes because it was causing a lot of confusion. Also, the environmental management was at its lowest ebb. There was refuse everywhere. The people too were disenchanted because we had a government that didn't patronize the artisans in the states. So we also had a government that was heavily indebted and had committed the state to ISO. So we came in, we had the hardest start to governance in this country because there was no handing over properly done. Again, we were inundated with challenges, legal challenges, political challenges, where a group of lawmakers who are not even resident in the state are saying we are coming to the state to impeach or remove the governor.
We're coming to the issue of the lawmakers, which is,
right.
But I'm more concerned about the infrastructure development.
You yes.
They are people-based.
They are people-based.
Now, the Ojaoba market,
yes.
Land reconstruction,
yes.
is that also people-based?
That
Did
is
government
a,
take the people into consideration in the demolition of the market
and
the promised reconstruction in January, which is yet to see the light of day?
It's seen the light of day. Every project you execute goes through a planning chain. The Ojaoba market is an industry of its own. There are more than 10,000 people employed in that market who send their children to school from that market, either as retailers, wholesalers, or even middlemen. So we needed to do something. But we had a fire disaster in that market. That was the precursor to the demolition and the planned reconstruction. Not that it is.
Was there any plan for resettlement?
Yes, we had plans. We had
a temporary shelter.
No, temporary shelter. But
where are the traders now?
The traders are in two spots. We have some in our daily market, where traders have settled down into their shops. We allocated land and they built on them. We have over 200, 300 shops there now. And people are still building. Because whether you like it or not, the market was becoming inadequate because the city itself is getting bigger by the day.
Honorable Commissioner, are you aware
yes,
that some of the traders are trading just by the side, by the roadside?
Is
that very good for, you know, the metropolitan development of Ado Ekiti?
Every development.
If there is traffic on that highway now, accidents are possibly waiting to happen.
We have continued, and I'm using this medium again to appeal to the people. But first of all, you have to understand that every process of conception and birth has some stress and strain.
Why weren't they allowed to trade in December so that at least they could make some money for the Yuletide celebration?
Well, government does not work with celebrations. Government works with programs. You can only do construction during the dry season. And you cannot say because a particular religion, a particular festival.
But isn't that insensitivity on the part of the government? A government that is especially owing salaries.
Especially since we have given shops alternative places and people will go look for. There will always be new markets, new shopping malls, new places being built, and it will be patronized.
Can you explain the heavy indebtedness of your government to civil servants?
There is nothing like heavy indebtedness. I think we should be giving kudos because we...
Like heavy indebtedness?
Yeah.
Pensioners are being owed 6 months. Civil servants are being owed leave bonuses.
No,
they're being owed salaries.
No.
As much as four months.
No, even we have paid the promotion arrears for 2014. We are doing our best within the available resources. We were committed to an ISO, you know, by the last government. At the last deduction, 924 million naira is being deducted from our allocations. And you see our debt profile, you know, is going up, and our revenue base, both from federal allocations and from, you know, IGR, because there is not so much economic activity going on here now. So
why isn't government coming up with creative ways to ensure that economic
activity
is springing up in Ekiti State? Where are the investors? Ekiti State is supposed to be agrarian.
So we just put out an SMEs of 500 million naira to serious young people who want to go into agriculture. We do seminars every day. We encourage them. And we are trying to partner. We just set up a mineral development commission to partner with federal government and remove the gray areas so that investors can come in and partner with us in mineral resources development. We did the educational summit because you must have sand people. Ekiti State is known to be sand. When we left, we were seventh in performance in WAEC and NECO. When we came back, we were 34th behind.
Back to the debt. Are you blaming the last administration for the debt?
We are not here. Back to the debt. We have not borrowed money for any of those, you know, those. We don't want to go to all, into all
but
of that.
But you're partaking of the bailout handed out to governors owing salaries.
Yes, because the bailout itself is not a bailout. It's a bailing, if you like. Because
explain that.
Okay, good. We were given we asked for 27 billion because this instruction from Central Bank is, you know, compute all your salary, overheads, arrears. And that's why I will tell you that you should just give us kudos because we were owing about 27 billion local government and state. So, but the Central Bank approved 9.1 billion at 9% interest. And when you calculate that, the 9 billion will be paying back, this state will be paying back until 2036. About 31 billion.
In the treasury.
We met 87. There was a lot of controversy at first, but we met an 87 billion naira on cleared effects, debt commitments, loans, debentures, bank loans, even some that were not professional, you know, like 5 billion naira loan taken after the elections had been won and lost. You know, you don't go at that stage, and those debts didn't even pass through the National Debt Office because we had borrowed to our limits. So it was an undercover thing. And then why do you do that? And then they went away with 109 official cars. So right now, no commissioner is on any car. We are using the project vehicles.
Now, you blame the last administration for much of your predicament, but isn't the situation this administration finds itself in now, and indeed other governments in other states, isn't it a cumulative effect of the lifestyle and the absence of the prioritization of industrialization by past governments that has brought state governments to their knees at the moment?
I agree with you that when you look at it holistically, Nigeria hasn't been well run. But when you look at it from our own...
Do you take responsibility? You
when belong we were, to when we
a,
were
a living, former government we, as well.
Yes, we were in this state as a government, in all the 16 local governments. I was in that government. We left a 10.4 billion naira credit in the account of the state. We met 4 point something billion naira debt, where all our houses in Abuja and Lagos were used as collaterals. We redeemed that. We paid the Wema Bank counterpart funding, which was about 1 billion.
All right. Thank you very much, Honorable Commissioner. You're still on to fireworks. We're still talking with the Commissioner for Information, Ekiti State, Honorable Lanre Ogbuchie. We'll be right back with more questions agitating your minds. Stay with fireworks. Thank you for staying tuned to Fireworks. We have been talking with the Honorable Commissioner, Ekiti State, and person of Honorable Lanre Ogbuchie. And in the last half hour, we have been looking at the reason the state is in its present predicament. We're making progress now to some of the criticisms thrown at the Ekiti State government, especially about some of the policy decisions in that government. Now, the reintroduction of school fees in public primary schools. We want to know what informed those decisions. Now, we also gather that pupils in primary schools, students in private primary and secondary schools in the state are being levied 1,000 naira. Can you tell us why this is so?
Thank you very much. I think we should all be honest with ourselves. You probably have your children in fee-paying schools. I have mine in fee-paying schools. And because we want a better future for them. I told you we were 34th. Behind states that had insurgency in educational ratings. So the decision is not our decision. We had an educational summit. We had the stakeholders, the teachers, the principals, the head teachers. Among all the things, I'm surprised that the only thing you mentioned is the school fees. What about the introduction of the tutor general? What about the award to the best teacher in primary schools? We gave them cars. Because you need to energize that department. If people are not getting educated, and I want to add this, we got the Transparency Award for the best implemented budget in this country last year. We didn't give the award to ourselves. It was done in Abuja. So we are going to be trying.
So are you justifying the payment of tax by underage people?
It's not tax, it's educational fees. Because you and I know that in this country, if you don't do anything about the educational sector, if you continue to play to the gallery and say free education when you cannot provide the quality of education that is needed, you will just end up.
So the government, in its desperation to
not
generate
government.
Revenue,
no, not
is
government.
Taxing on the road.
No, parents are saying
in the society now 1,000 naira.
Parents are the ones paying those fees. Children who don't work can be taxed.
But the parents too are paying taxes. If those parents happen to be civil servants in the state,
it's the era of Savicom.
Taxes, pay as you earn.
It's the era of Savicom. Don't complain about what you are
paying.
Besides the other taxes that they pay, it's like saying once you pay your taxes, you don't pay your water rates. No, that's not the idea. You are paying for two different things. And I'm telling you that in the era of Savicom, it's not about trying to get free service. It's about ensuring that what you pay for...
You need to collect ₦1,000 on the Honorable Commission to provide quality education.
Yes, yes, because in those schools that you show, that you and I know, you find schools that need just ₦1,000 to call carpenters to fix desks, and they cannot fix those desks. And those children sit on the floor. Hang on.
There's private schools?
I'm talking about public schools. But
private parents who have children in private schools are paying these levies.
The parents in those private schools in the first place are paying school fees, and they are just paying ₦1,000 more to ensure one supervision of their schools, because we can't just leave it to them. And government cannot continue to fund standardization, supervision of those schools without asking those schools, those institutions, to be a part of the cost. Because we are living in the era of reality. We cannot, government alone, there was a time where there was an educational drive and you had to go to people's houses. And then again, this brings us to the area of procreation. If you had just a few children and all of them are not going to be in school the same time, the same class, if you have just a few children, you don't have a problem with paying ₦1,000 a year on one child. It is when you have
extremely large families. To provide quality service to the people.
Yeah.
Welfare, to ensure that the welfare of the people is guaranteed. Isn't that part of the promises of government?
Thank you.
Government at that time tell the people that they were going to pay for it?
Nigeria, we need to educate ourselves and we need to live in reality. Nigeria is the only country where treated water is used to wash cars. Nigeria is the only country where treated water is used to wash clothes. And Nigeria is the only country where your tap breaks down and it runs for 2 weeks. And government pays for that. You cannot design the government policies for different segments of society. There will be people who will feel there is no need to pay. But there were parents who came into that place and spoke the truth and said, my children can't go to public schools now because I know it's not well funded and the results are horrible. We had graduates who only had their certificates and know nothing about what they do.
When we came in
to administration, the first thing we did was to reduce school fees of the university by 20,000 per pupil because it was too high.
By the way, we also gathered that traders in some marketplaces are being asked to pay ₦40,000 annually. What is this?
No, nobody is.
What is this money for?
Nobody is being.
Is this besides the rent they pay on their shops?
They don't pay rent like in our daily. Once we allocate you the land, you own it forever. It's not about letting it to you. It is about ownership. Each time you want to leave the children of the poor and you say, come up with something. Don't forget we have bursary, we have scholarship, we have empowered the artisans with about 1.2 billion. We have injected 500 million into the system. Because even if you are asked to pay ₦100, if you are not productive, you can't pay it. So what we did is to go to the economic sector and energize it such that parents can bear responsibility for their children. And bearing responsibility for your own child that you conceived, you had, gave a name on the 7th or 8th day, you must know it comes with responsibilities. And the people themselves are not the ones complaining. In fact, they are proud to say, I am paying.
Oh, but we gather that the people are afraid of complaining because they know the kind of governor they have. Do you know that they are scared of your governor? And they accuse him of being a democratic tyrant.
My governor goes about with minimum security. One, you saw my governor lifting the handicap from the ground to the wheelchair for our 1 year anniversary. You see him in the market giving out rice. During the Hausa outside Yoruba community. You saw him climbing the bus and moving people and going to stay with them at Shasha. We have a governor.
And we also see him in the news laying ambush for civil servants.
Who came late?
Who come late.
Fine, that's good.
And
did you see me on that?
And we also see him presenting and passing the budget himself.
See, hang on. Did you see me in that film where workers came late? I was there. I was in my office before 8. If you come late to your office, we don't have a business defending those who don't do their work. And that is, we don't even have to talk about it because the workers were contrite, they begged for coming late, and the governor pardoned them. But what kind of country would it be when the law and sympathy is on the side of the man that gets paid for not coming to work? People must come to work in Shell, in most multinational companies. Nobody needs to regulate you. In your company, in your company, it's time banned. A program starts by 8, and then you are just strolling in by 8:15.
If he wants to ensure discipline in the civil service, is it also discipline for him to present the budget and pass the budget himself?
No, he didn't present.
Hitting the gavel himself.
In Ekiti State here, we are one family. You call us Oshokites, if you like. We were driven away unfairly. We suffered perfidy. We were in the wilderness, and we all came back together. That budget was not prepared by the executive to be submitted to the legislative house. That budget is a people's budget. The legislators had their own input at the conception stage. The legislators were the formulators. We only fine-tuned it and then presented
the
it to them.
The legislators that he wants to work with.
Yes, they must have input. Otherwise, you begin to tinker with every page of the budget. Because budget is the intention of government to spend money. And if the people who are going to approve it are not involved in the planning stage, of course, the approval becomes difficult. But they were there, the market women were there, and you said,
how do we... legislators had time to deliberate on the budget? Look at it critically?
3 months before that budget was presented to that house...
Did this legislature pass this budget by themselves, or was it the governor that passed the budget? We have it on tape, Honorable Commissioner.
That the governor passed it?
Yes, the governor passed the budget himself.
No. You
and
cannot have it on tape. You cannot have it.
He's begun to starve his commissioners of funds. So you have a governor in Ekiti State who is governor, who is commissioner, who is lawmaker, all in one.
No, the Constitution 1 does not allow that. Reality does not allow that. And political expediency does not allow that. One man does not make a forest. But we have a team.
Do you have any system of checks and balances in Ekiti State?
We have a House of Assembly that is not harassing the governor.
A House of Assembly that is a stooge to the governor? That is an extension of the...
A House of Assembly that is a partner with the people and the governor.
Now let's talk about the multi-billion naira airport project. How do you justify that?
Not multi, just about 2-3 billion naira airstrip. One, everybody is stopping in Akure. The president is stopping in Akure. The ministers are stopping in Akure because that's the last place you have the air transport facility. We want here to be destination point. We want to make this place the educational destination point in the country. That's why you see our educational policies are a little bit radical and unique. And these people, we have, Ekiti State has, Adu Ekiti alone has about 2 universities and about 2 polytechnics and a few other. So we want people to be able to come here. We don't want them to stop in Akure. So that's why we are doing an airstrip. But when you hear airport, have you been to Syria? I've been to Syria. You don't necessarily need to have bogus airport. What you need is an efficient airport. It's like when you say, I want to buy a car. You can get a very good car for
an administration that is unable to meet with a salary commitment, wants to embark on a 3 billion naira airport project.
Yes, sometimes
an administration that is owing its pensioners of 6 months wants to embark on an airport
Let me tell you this. Ideally, you are supposed to spend 60% of your revenue on recurrent expenditure.
You have to pay nearly a billion naira until 2036 to meet your bail-in commitment.
I want to give you something that is the law, but we are ignoring it now. a certain percentage of whatever you earn, whether it is 1 naira, must go to developmental projects. Remember, it is not everybody in the state that is a civil servant. You must put some money in projects. It is just that salary is our priority.
So an airstrip is the realistic project that you must
That airstrip was started more than 10 years ago. Every administration came and paid lip service to it, just like the bitumen project of Ondo State. You need political will. When we were going to do the double carriageway, which you are now enjoying in Ado-Ekiti, people said it wasn't priority. But today, it's there, and everybody is using it. It's not party. If you have an airstrip in Ado, nobody is going to prevent anybody from using it. Instead of going to, and it's going to cost less than 3 billion naira. And then we have, in this state, used 3 billion naira to build one house for just one family. And then nobody was talking then. We are not bothered. What we know is that history and posterity will judge those who have striven to improve this state.
You can't just pay salaries.
You can't just pay salaries for 4 years. In fact, salary payment shouldn't be an achievement. It should be something that you have taken for granted.
Yes, we've been talking with the Honorable Commissioner, Youth, Sports and Social Development, Ekiti State. And you've heard his defense for the government on some of the policy decisions that the Ekiti State government has embarked upon and the attendant effect consequences on the people of Ekiti State. So you're left with your own summations about happenings and development in the Fountain of Knowledge State. On behalf of the entire production crew, I am Bukola Samuel Wemimo, urging you to join us again same time next week when we'll bring you another interesting edition of the program. Bye for now.